Thank you. Thanks for the introduction. So I'm going to talk about federated learning. So as we know, machine learning has a huge potential to transform a lot of different industries and with a lot of very nice applications that we see at this event. But what is the cornerstones of all these applications is the ability to collect data. Typically, how we do machine learning applications is we collect data is from different centers, from different users, from different plants into a data center. And then data scientists play with this data to train a very good machine learning model. And this is great because it allows them to collect a large enough volume of data. So of course, it may depend on the application, what the good volume is and what the good quality is. And it's very flexible. But the issue with this approach is that data is sent once, and sometimes it's hard to refresh, to link the previous records with the new ones. Also, centralizing everything is possible only if you don't have too many regulations. And even if you can, if data is very sensitive, then having everything in a single place can be, in terms of security, a bit of a risk, because if there is a breach, everything is lost. And also, since data sometimes is very strategic, centers or players, depending on the field, may simply not be willing to share the datasets. Think, for instance, of competitors which have data on the same approach, but they do not want to share them with their competitors. And so this is where federated learning kicks in. The federated learning approach is the idea of not centralizing data, but keeping data in the centers of origin. We add processing powers in these different centers, and machine learning models are trained there. But then there is some coordination for the training of the different models, typically here with a central server, which will be, for instance, aggregating the different models. And this is great because in this case, we can still train a model which has seen indirectly the data set from all the different centers. So we have reached a good volume of data, and we are able to do a lot of different things. But data remains in different centers, and this increases the privacy level. Also, this makes it easier to refresh data because data stays at the center of origin. And last but not least, centers keep a control on how data is used. If the system is well built, it allows to track what is done on the system. Typically in Hawking's case, hospitals can monitor what's happening. And if they detect a malicious behavior, they can cut and remove the permissions, for instance. So this is the main idea of federated learning, which is pretty general. And the goal is to enhance the privacy level. But federated learning can be used in conjunction with other privacy enhancing techniques. For instance, as I mentioned, it's possible to add some traceability features to really monitor what is going on, what is happening, possibly with unforgeable methods, unforgeable ledger which will record everything. Also, it's possible to add some secure multi-party computation features which will prevent the central server from seeing the individual gradients that are sent by the different centers, and other different techniques if need be. What is important is that it's really adaptable, and it depends on the requirements and on the threat model. Maybe in the defense industry, there are a lot of high stakes, and one needs to protect against almost everything. And in different settings, it's a different threat model, and you can adapt it with the federated learning backbone. So at Hawking, we conduct methodological research and development to enable this technology. In terms of algorithmic challenges, there are three main. The first one is the fact that we're talking about distributed machine learning. So although there has been a lot of work in this field, in some niche studies, there are still some issues when you want to distribute an arbitrary machine learning model. And also, there is still the problem of computation versus communication efficiency. Another issue that arises is the fact that data is non-IID, because different centers have different environments, they have different tools that they use, and data may not follow the same distributions. And it's important to adapt the machine learning model and the federated learning procedure to take this into account. The last issue is that even though data is not moved, the model updates can still leak indirectly some information either on the data or in the centers themselves, and it's important to protect against these privacy risks. And we do this not only on the federated learning part, so the machine learning part, but in fact across the whole federated data science cycle. We cover also data exploration, machine learning, and model validation. This research is then translated into a software that we call Hawking Connect. This is a federated learning software that is deployed in different hospitals, each of them containing rich multimodal data, such as the genomic data or histopathology data. And this allows Hawking to build what we call our platform, which is a platform of data sets that we use then to build solutions and products, such as clinical trial optimization tools or diagnostic tools that will help us build better treatment and diagnostics for patients. Okay, so I will now show you some examples of real-world implementations of federated learning. The first one is Melody. Melody is a consortium between 10 different pharmaceutical companies, many different public partners, and which is funded by the IMI. The goal of this project is to train a machine learning model to predict some chemical properties of small compounds. It's a very important task for the drug discovery pipeline of pharmaceutical companies. And each pharmaceutical company has spent a lot of money, a lot of effort to build, to make really chemical experiments and to have information on different compounds. And the idea is that, okay, they all have maybe explored different space, some subparts of the whole space of chemical molecules. And maybe if you took the union of all the data sets, we could, they all could benefit from it. And so in a real, without federated learning, this would be hardly possible because they have invested a lot of money. This is really valuable and also sensitive information because it contains information on their research pipeline and therefore on the market, on the drugs that will push to markets, maybe their pricing strategies. So it's really something that they do not want to disclose to their arch competitors. But still, with federated learning, they have agreed to work together to build this machine learning model on a very large data set, in fact. And so the project is still going on. These are some early results from last year's run. The graph shows the improvements that is made possible by the federated learning strategy for different metrics for different pharmaceutical companies which are anonymized. What you can see is that it does bring an improvement. Of course, the scale varies across the different pharmaceutical companies, which is normal because there is some statistical heterogeneity. So it's not exactly the same data sets. But still, on average, it does bring something. Now, let me show you another example. This is HealthChain. This is a consortium that Hawking is piloting between to study treatment response in breast cancer. So this is the project on a quite rare disease, triple negative breast cancer. So this is a cancer in which patients do not respond to effective hormonal therapy, and typically they undergo neoadjuvant chemotherapy. This is a chemotherapy which is very toxic for the hearts, and in some cases it simply doesn't work. Which is and the issue is that it's hard to predict for clinicians if they respond or not. And what we wanted to investigate in this project is if we would be able to predict the response directly from some diagnostics information, such as a biopsy slide, to better predict the response. And then such a predictor could be used if they respond well, we can diminish the dose, and if they respond, it will be less toxic. And if they don't respond, we already direct them through more experimental treatments. And so we built a consortium between Institut Curie in France, in Paris, and Centre Lambert in Lyon, France, together one of the largest data sets on this disease ever published, with a real federated learning network, meaning it's behind each hospital's firewall, and there are really some stringent constraints here. So these are some early results from this collaboration. The results show that, first, it's possible to predict the response from the slides directly, and with a performance that is slightly better than the local than what clinicians would do. So this is already great. And further, using a federated learning technique on top of this increases performance and makes it also more resilient. So if you want more details, I invite you to check out this preprint paper. So these were just two examples of consortia, but there are many others which are starting, Big Picture and Optima, for instance. So to sum up, federated learning is the idea of connecting different centers, each holding sensitive data sets, and making the machine learning models and all data science quantities travel rather than the data themselves. This ensures compliance and increases the privacy level. And in particular, for highly regulated data, this opens new opportunity to apply machine learning across silos. And I'm sure that a lot of different industries would be interested in this. At Okin, we use it to unlock biomedical research at scale. Thank you for your attention. I'd be happy to take any question now or afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have questions? So I was wondering if you have like a few insights from the trenches, things that you, because my hunch is that there might be a lot of tricks of the trade that you need to know in order to get these get federated learning to work in these settings. Do you have any practical advice for us?
So maybe a practical advice is not to underestimate the non-technical issues. That in particular, so technically making it work is something, but there is also, in particular, when you want to work with hospitals, there is also a lot of other departments. You need to convince on the legal aspects, the IT guys, and this is also important.
And how much time does it usually take to add this layer of, in terms of development time?
This depends on the setting. It can take several months.
Okay, thank you very much. Oh, there's one more question. Maybe let me check the time quickly. Oh, we have plenty of time, I think.
Thank you for your presentation, really clear. I've got two questions, well, one after another. The first one is like, you mentioned that we need to have like a central server, an aggregator that will securely aggregate the different models. But we all know that like there are plenty of attacks based on model, for example, membership influence attack or like getting the statistical distribution from a model. So how do you ensure and how do you guarantee to all of the different parties, stakeholders, especially if it's about health data, that you are safe and that the model is safe?
Yeah, thanks. This is a good question. So as I mentioned, it's possible to combine raw federated learning in a sense with additional privacy enhancing techniques such as secure aggregation, for instance, which will prevent you from seeing all the individual updates and that may increase the privacy level. And you can use other ones for maybe differential privacy if you want to increase it even further.